IntelliJ IDEA can significantly reduce the amount of typing you have to do while coding. In this screencast, we're going to look at how. We'll start with a plain no-frills Java project, so we can see how much work IntelliJ IDEA can do for us from an empty start. There's a more detailed look at getting started with a new project in another screencast. We're also going to use the keyboard for the majority of our navigation, as demonstrated in the navigation screencast. IntelliJ IDEA has created a source directory for our production Java code, but we need to create a directory for our test code. We can use Alt-Insert on Windows or Command-N on the Mac to create something new. Here in the project window, we're going to create a new directory. We need to tell IntelliJ IDEA this is for test code, so we can right-click and mark it as a test directory. Now we have the basic directories, we can create our Java packages. Typing in the new drop-down lets us narrow down the options to the ones we want. We can type the full package name here, and IntelliJ IDEA will create the correct directory structure for this package. Now we have a package, we can create a new Java class. In this first example, we're going to create a simple main class. You can see IntelliJ IDEA creates a main.java file with the appropriate package and class declaration already filled in. Next, we can use a feature called Live Templates to create standard template code without having to type much. We type PSVM and press Tab or Enter, and IntelliJ IDEA creates a public static void main method for the class and places our cursor inside the method body. There are a lot of live templates for generating common code. If we want to print something to system.out, we can type sout, and again we have a number of options. We'll select the simplest option and print the string hello. Running the class gives us the output we expect. That's just a taste of how IntelliJ IDEA can help us while we're coding. Let's look at a slightly more realistic example. We're going to use a test-driven development approach to create some basic shape functionality. Firstly, we'll use Alt and Insert, or Command and N, again to create our new class. Then, when we have our skeleton class, we can use Alt and Enter on the class name and select Create Test to create a unit test for this class. IntelliJ IDEA supports a number of standard testing libraries out of the box. We're going to use JUnit 5 for our tests. The IDE tells us we don't have the JUnit 5 jar files on the class path, and we can use the Fix button to download the libraries from Maven Central and put them on the class path so they're available for us to use. We have the option to generate some of the structure of the test class, but we don't need to for these examples. IntelliJ IDEA adds assertions as a static import to make it as easy as possible for us to write tests that compile straight away. The IDE has created this test file in the test sources root in the appropriate package, creating all the right directory structure for us. We can use generate again to create a new test method. This is annotated with the JUnit 5 annotation, and IntelliJ IDEA expects us to change the method name to something more meaningful. And on pressing enter, our cursor is placed inside the method body. IntelliJ IDEA offers a number of different types of code completion that can help us as we create the test. Various options are offered by default as we type. We don't even need to use a shortcut to bring up the suggestions. The suggestions are not just for types, but are even made for variable names. We can provoke suggestions by using Control and Space, which gives us basic completion. Using Shift Control Space invokes smart completion. This is type aware and only suggests options that are the correct type for the context. In this case, we only had one type that fitted, so IntelliJ IDEA automatically selected square for us. Typing a dot will bring up the list of available options on a symbol. If we want to create some new functionality on this class, we can choose to ignore what's there already and define our new method name. The editor will warn us that this method doesn't exist, but if we press Alt and Enter on this red method, we can choose to create this missing method. IntelliJ IDEA can use the information we've already provided to create this method structure. For example, this method returns an int, because in the test we assigned the results of calling this method to an int variable. In the spirit of test-driven development, we'll leave this as the simplest thing that compiles and go back to the test. Now we can define what we expect the result to be. Note that IntelliJ IDEA's code completion suggestions can work on partial method names and camel case to make it easier to find the method we need with minimal typing and minimal risk of misspelling. When we run the test, we see it fails, but this is expected. Let's go back to the implementation and make the simplest change that will fix the test. Now we have a passing test, we can safely refactor the code. For example, here we might want to move this hard-coded value into a field. We can initialize the value in the current method, in the field declaration, or in the constructor. We can also use Alt and Enter to see options for changing where we initialize it if we want to. There are other screencasts which go into refactoring in more depth. Here we've seen a taste of how we can use it to automatically generate the code we want. We can use refactoring to generate new files for us as well. For example, now we have the Square class, we might want to create a shape interface for it to implement. Here I'm using find action to call extract interface. Let's create an interface called shape and add the getNumberOfSides method to it. We're not going to replace the current usages of Square with shape, but we could if we wanted to. We can see IntelliJ IDEA has updated Square to implement our new shape interface and added the override annotation to getNumberOfSides. We can see our shape interface is fairly straightforward. Let's create a new type of shape. This time we're going to create the test class before we create the class that is testing. Again, we can generate our test method and call it something appropriate. We can define a shape local variable. This time we want it to be a new type, polygon. IntelliJ IDEA lets us create this new class using Alt and Enter and places it into the correct directory. Because we are using this from a shape variable, IntelliJ IDEA correctly assumes we want this polygon to implement our shape interface. The editor is showing an error since polygon doesn't implement the shape methods yet, and we can use Alt and Enter again and select Implement Methods to fix this problem. As usual, we can accept the simplest implementation that compiles in order to continue writing our test. In the test, we can continue coding to create the API we want and getting IntelliJ IDEA to make the changes we need. The IDE can create fields for constructor parameters that aren't currently being used. Once again, now the code compiles, we can define our test expectations and rerun the test. Of course it fails, so we return the number of sides field value from the method and see the test is passing as expected. Often domain objects like this require some standard methods. We can get IntelliJ IDEA to generate these methods for us. For example, we can generate a toString method, defining which fields should be included. There are a number of templates we can use to create the method, depending upon which standard approach we want to choose. Generated methods are usually placed wherever the caret was. Let's use the same process to generate the equals and hashcode methods. Again, we have options for the way we want the generated method to work. We can choose which fields to include in the equals method and which to use in hashcode. While having these methods in a class, and even generating them like this is quite standard for Java programmers, it can lead to a bit of noise and mess in our domain objects. We can apply consistent organization to our classes by automatically rearranging our code. Here I'm going to use find action to search for rearrange code and apply it to this class. Here we're using the default settings for code organization, which is place the constructor at the top of the class, would put any inner classes at the bottom of the file, and will organize fields, for example, grouping static fields together. We can change the existing settings to suit our needs, or even add our own rules. For example, I would like all my getter methods to be below any other methods that might contain business logic, since the getters are not as important to see. Note that we can use regular expressions to define a pattern for method name. Even less important than the getters are the other generated methods, so let's create a rule to put them underneath all the other types of methods. Now, when we rearrange the code, the getter is put above the other generated methods. Let's create some more business logic and see how code generation and code completion helps us here. We continue to use the test to drive the design of the API. For this functionality, it makes sense that we'll pass into the polygon constructor some sort of array or collection that contains the lengths of all the sides in the polygon. Here I'm going to use postfix completion to define the variable. IntelliJ IDEA offers a range of postfix completion options to help generate common code. Press the up arrow on the completion list to see all the ones that are available for the current context. We'll use var to create a local variable for this polygon. When creating variables, we don't have to accept the default type. We can press Shift and Tab to put the focus on the type and see which options are available. For this example, I don't want to define it with a shape interface, but with the polygon class itself. This constructor doesn't exist yet, so IntelliJ IDEA gives us the option to either modify the existing constructor or to create another constructor. If we choose to modify the existing constructor, we'll see the Change Signature dialog, which lets us customize the method to our needs. We already have a test that uses the existing constructor, so for now, we're going to create a new constructor that meets the needs of this test. We can always refactor later. We should do something with both parameters to the new constructor. IntelliJ IDEA recognizes that there's a field that matches the name of the first constructor parameter, so we can get it to generate the code to assign this parameter to the correct field. The second parameter doesn't have a field yet, so we'll get IntelliJ IDEA to create it for us. We've created this as a final field, but it hasn't been initialized in the field or in the original constructor. We'll get IntelliJ IDEA to initialize this field to a zero-length array in the original constructor. Now the code compiles, we can go ahead and write the rest of the logic for the test. Note that code completion doesn't require us to type much at all, especially for methods we've already called in this class. Again, we can use smart completion to suggest the methods that return a type that's compatible with this method. But we don't have the method we need yet, so let's define its name in this test and create it using Alt and Enter again. We can choose whether the method belongs on the interface or the implementation. For now, we'll put it on the implementation as we only need it on Polygon right now. We can refactor it later if we need to. Once again, we want to choose the simplest code that works and see the test turn red. Now we're going to implement the logic to make the test pass. We're going to want to iterate over our side lengths field. Iteration is another example of standard code that we can generate. For example, we could use postfix completion again. In this case, the key for iterating is iter. This will generate a standard foreach to iterate over the array. Alternatively, there are a number of different live templates for iteration. We could select itar, which creates a classic for loop to iterate over the array. Or we could use iter to create a foreach loop. We'll create a simple check to assign the longest value we find to the local variable longest. We can use quick fixes to make our code compile where necessary. Now we have our business logic, we'll rerun the test to see if it passes. Now we have a passing test, we can refactor our code safely knowing we can always run the test to make sure it still passes. For example, we could use the Java 8 inspections to automatically convert this for loop into a Streams API call. Rerunning the test shows this gives the same result as the previous code. I personally find Streams calls easier to read if each method is on a separate line. Let's select this code and use Alt and Enter to adjust how the code is formatted. This settings dialog shows just the settings that apply to the selected piece of code. We're going to select Wrap Always on Chain Method Calls. You can see the editor previews the formatting changes without us needing to save them. We can select Save if we're happy with these settings. Now the code is formatted this way, I can see the filter criteria more clearly. I have a theory that we don't need this filter, since the max method alone will give us what we need. Let's delete this line and rerun the test to make sure it all still works. Which it does. Finally, let's call rearrange code again to make sure the newly generated method is in the right place. We've used IntelliJ IDEA's code generation to create standard Java code, so we don't have to type in the code we sometimes refer to as boilerplate. We've also used the different types of code completion to help us to write the code we need, again reducing the typing required and allowing us to focus on the actual problems we're trying to solve. Thanks for watching.